Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Warm welcome to everybody joining us here in the sanctuary, as well as those joining us online. Happy second week of Easter, if you recognize that. A lot of churches do. And for a lot of churches, this Sunday is, they call it Thomas Sunday. And they really focus on when Jesus called Thomas to put aside his doubt and believe in him. And so I thought it would be a good idea to start our service by reading that account. In John 20, beginning at verse 19, says, "On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, 'Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, I am sending you.' And with that, he breathed on them and said, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven.' Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, was one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe.' A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe.' Jesus said to Thomas said to him, 'My Lord and my God.' Then Jesus told them, 'Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen, yet have believed.' Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this new spring day that you have made and for another opportunity to gather together here in your house and into your presence. We thank you for the blessings of the past week and for walking with us in every trial and circumstance. We thank you for being our risen Lord and living Savior. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your faithfulness and for your mercy. Help us today to do as Thomas did, to put aside any doubts and to believe anew, and to know that you are our Lord and our God. May your name be glorified and praised today. O Lord, and O our Lord and our God, be glorified today. We commit this service to you today. We pray that you would do your work in it. We pray that you would work through it. Help us, O Lord, to quiet our minds and to hear your voice and to be equipped for your service this week. We pray this all in the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who's coming again. Amen. In terms of the announcements for the week, praise the Lord, we broke a four-year record in terms of attendance. There were 66 of us in attendance last week. So if you look around, there's not 66 here today, so I'm giving you an assignment. I want you to look around, and I want you to think back to last week. Who was in the pew with you last week that's not here today? Or who was in the pews that were behind you or in front of you that you don't see here today? I'm going to put this on myself as well. Let's all commit to reaching out with a phone call, with a text, with a word this week to people that we don't see here. And let's tell them how great it was to see them here in God's house last week and how much we miss them here this week. Can we commit to doing that right now? Look around. I know the Lord's putting a name on your heart right now. Let's reach out to those people this week. The rest of the announcements are pretty self-explanatory. We've got a lot going on in the coming weeks ahead. Big one coming up next Saturday is Jake's Eagle Ceremony. There is a sign-up sheet there in the Fellowship Hall. And Spring Cleanup Day on the 29th. If you can't come on the 29th, no worries. There's plenty to do on other days as well. So please sign up, or not sign up, just come anytime if you have some time, if you could help us out with that as well. This time, let's sing a hymn, number 272, "Crown Him with Many Crowns." Want to play first?
In case you can't hear all the video. And for 6 weeks starting today, and a lot of us didn't get this out ahead of time, so a lot of them might not be prepared. But out on the table where the pastor stands and the bulletins are, there's a red bucket. You can put in loose change or loose check, whatever, in the red bucket, and that's going to collect it every week. Or we have two sets of envelopes. There's individual envelopes in one box, different colors, can't miss them. And there's also baggies with a number of envelopes in it. You can use the baggie, you can use the envelopes. And each week you can bring them in, or you can bring one envelope in during the whole 6 weeks. It doesn't have to be a weekly thing. If you want to contribute at all, you can do it any time during the 6 weeks. Our goal is $1,000. Last year we just reached over $1,000. A little bit over it. This year we have a few more people come to church, and we figured we'd go for $1,000 again to see what we can do. And who knows? The Lord blesses. So there's envelopes, there's bucket, and you can see any of the women's group members, and we'd be glad to help you out if you have any questions. And yesterday we had a speaker, some of you made it to hear Catherine and Vicki. A lot of the missions work, the people that are involved in the missions, what they're doing on the field, are in the prayer guide booklets that are out in the fellowship hall if you haven't gotten one. So if you want to see a little more in detail what's going on with the missions fields and what the needs are, the prayer guides are a good source. And the other thing that we always forget to mention is if you do write out a check, if you can make it out to the WHNFMS, that way the church doesn't have to transfer between treasurers and rewrite checks. If you can. Okay? So they're out there on the table behind the pastor when you're leaving. You can just grab them.
I just got one more thing to add to that. Over those weeks that we're collecting for Penny Crusade, I'll be taking returnable bottles back to the stores to support that. All of that will be going also to the Penny Crusade. So if anybody's got bottles and cans, returnables at home, if you can put them like in a 30-gallon trash bag or whatever, you can leave them on the stairway, the rampway out in the back there. And I know tomorrow or Tuesday I will be bringing some to return. But over the next few weeks, anytime you've got returnables, please bring them if you don't mind donating them, and that will certainly go toward that mission as well. So thank you for that.
Great. All right, thank you so much. Go to prayer, and I wonder, what can we be praying for? Any specific prayer needs this morning?
Okay.
Yeah, Cindy?
All right. I mentioned to you yesterday, when I let the congregation know, my aunt who was diagnosed with a leukemia and chose to go on hospice passed away on Friday, so prayers for her daughter Joanne and the family.
Bill, please.
I said going through recovery, pretty good. Just be praying for me to keep something.
Okay. Well, this Matt?
Yeah.
What? I'm not sure. I may have missed him. What's he recovering from? Did he have surgery?
You know, he had an intestine problem.
Oh.
Intestinal.
Okay.
Inflammation.
Okay. So recovery from that. Absolutely.
It was severe.
Okay. Anyone else? Joe?
Yes. First for my friend Pete got in this Michigan, who will be having his second hip surgery soon.
You said Pete, right, though?
Yeah.
Okay.
I went from my medical cardiogram
yesterday,
and he got back to me the next day, and he said at this point there were a few different things, but he said at this point in time there's no reason to panic or anything. But did discover there and have stood back and said yes, that was discovered years back. And if I had some oxygen light, I think it's a couple hours a night. If I had I sleep over position, I'm feeling all right. So that was on top of me that, you know, stop being nervous.
Okay. Good. Anyone else? Let's go to prayer together. Father, we thank you so much for this day and this opportunity to be with you once again. And Lord, as we're watching the video and thinking about missions, and Lord, I can't help but think that's how every single one of us here came to know about you, through someone else, either volunteering to teach a Sunday school class or volunteered to bring you to church or invited you, Lord. That's what it's all about. So we thank you, Lord, that we can be involved. Because obviously, probably everyone in this room is never going to get to where these people are that we read about. But Lord, we could be a part of that in our giving. So thank you for that opportunity. Thank you for our missionaries around the world and the work that they do, God. Thank you so much. Thank you for yesterday, Lord, with Catherine being here and sharing. Some exciting things that are going on. Be with her this morning in Bristol. But just thank you for a great day yesterday. And Lord, you are just an awesome God. And as we come before you, we want to lift up these specific requests. We want to lift up the family of Joanna, lost her mom this week, and Cindy's aunt. Lord, just be with this family. Lord, thank you for being with them, and I pray that you continue to be with them, Lord, in the days ahead. Lord, I want to lift up Milt's son, Matt, to you, God, and I pray that you would be with his recovery. Lord, that you'd be getting better and better every day. Just want to lift him up today, God. Lord, be with Bill's friend, Pete. He's going to have another hip surgery soon, and you know the details about that, God. Would you please go before him and prepare those doctors and help everything to go smoothly there? God, we thank you that Joe got pretty good news. Thank you, Lord, for being with him and continue to be with him, Lord. Thank you so much for that. And Lord, we want to continue to lift Morris before you. Thank you that he's out of the hospital and doing a little better. But God, I just want to pray for those nurses and such at the healthcare facility, Lord, that you would just be with him, that you would use them, Lord, to care for him. Thank you so much for watching over him. God, you are just a mighty God, an awesome God. We love you so much. And thank you, God, that no matter what we hear today, may we hear that you love us, Lord. Lord, we look in the mirror and we don't think we're very lovable. But that's not how you see it. You love us. You sent your son to die for each one of us. That's how much you love us, God. Help us to remember that, Lord, as we walk out those doors. We love you, Lord. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I'm thinking of it. Morris is actually, I keep forgetting the name. The facility on Fern Drive. It changes names a lot, but that's the one he's at. Anybody
Regal
know?
Regal Healthcare.
What is it?
Regal Healthcare.
Regal Healthcare. Okay, so continue. Keep him.
Scripture reading for the morning is found in the book of 1 Peter. You're reading 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better, if it is God's will, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. May God have a blessing to the reading of his word.
You would now join us again. The first song we're going to be doing right now is called Above All. And the one line that kind of sticks out for me is it says, you took the fall. You took the fall. Jesus in God, you took the fall and thought of me above all.
Let's stand again.
Of all wisdom and all the ways.
Announcement on the slide, but tomorrow night is our next men's night, and if you've never come, we'd love to have you join us. We're going to go to Christie's tomorrow night, so we either can meet here at 6 or there at 6:30. We have a great time together as men, but let's just bow for a word of prayer this morning. Lord, we just, again, pause. We seek your face. Lord, we long to hear what you want us to hear this morning. Please, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, speak to each one of us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, what happened to Easter? Just last week, all the store shelves were stocked with Peeps and chocolate eggs and chocolate bunnies and all kinds of Easter candy. Easter dresses were in all the ads for the department stores. Charlton Heston made his annual appearance on TV, along with an assortment of other specials on the life of Jesus. Well, last Sunday, Easter was an amazing time to be here. As was mentioned, our congregation was bigger than it's been for a long, long time, and it was wonderful. But then what happened on Monday, though? Some maybe had a day off, but by Tuesday, life was back to normal for most of the world. Right? Kids were back at school for some, work was still work, and the Easter candy was marked down 75%. So what do we do now that Easter is over? Is the rest of the year just one big anti-climax? Well, actually, on the church calendar, Easter is not just a single holiday, but it's a whole season. It marks an entire chapter in the church year. So what do we do with Easter? Do we put it away like we put away all the Christmas decoration when it's over? Well, my guess is that we plant the Easter flowers and we'll be able to enjoy them for quite a while. But let me caution you not to put the candy and chocolate away because you'll not like it when you take it back out next year. But do we put the new Easter outfit or tie away? Well, even though the stores have put Easter away very, very quickly, it's not over. Really, it's just begun. Easter is what gives us hope. It's what keeps us going as believers and followers of Jesus. Well, maybe another or a better question is, well, what did the disciples do with what happened on Easter? Or maybe more importantly, what did Jesus want them to do? Well, we see some of that as Jesus gives the Great Commission. Matthew 28, here's what it says. Then Jesus came to them and said this, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." So we see here that the disciples have a to-do list from Jesus. They are to go and make disciples of all nations. They are to baptize them and teach them everything that Jesus commanded them. And then, of course, at the end, we see a big encouragement to the disciples. Jesus says, "Surely I am with you always." So they have this big to-do list for sure, but he's not simply just sending them out totally on their own, is he? In essence, he's going with them. Now, even though Jesus does give this to-do list to his disciples, it's still in effect today. This is the mandate for the church. We are to be making disciples, helping people in their walk with the Lord. We are to be baptizing people. And we are to be teaching people about Jesus and what he did and taught while he was here. But then, what about us individually as followers of Jesus? I don't think he expects us to be baptizing people in our bathtubs or our pools. At least I don't think so. But we can help in drawing people to church, and more importantly, to Jesus. We can be a light showing people the way to Jesus. And in our scripture, verse 15 specifically, I think we find the answer for how we are to do this. Listen to what Peter says. 1 Peter 3, verse 15. "But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have." First of all, I want to look at this hope. This hope should be fresh on our minds only a week away from Easter. And this hope is perfectly illustrated by the women going to the tomb on that first Easter morning. They went there to put spices on the body of Jesus. This was something they did back then. Today, we would bring flowers. Back then, they would bring spices or perfume. It was a sign of love and respect. But they went expecting to find the dead body of Jesus in the tomb. Of course, in their grief, it seems they didn't consider how they were going to roll the stone away. But Luke tells us that when they arrived, the stone was already rolled away. And as we look at the different gospel accounts, they all have different little details. For example, Peter and John running to the tomb to find it's empty. Or the two angels who appear to the women telling them, "He's not here, he's risen." John shares about Jesus appearing to Mary Magdalene when she thinks he's the gardener. Matthew shares Jesus appearing to Mary Magdalene and the other Mary as they were hurrying away to tell the disciples the news they had received from the angel. But the bottom line to each of these accounts is that Jesus has risen from the dead. Death could not hold him. He's conquered death once and for all. In Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, Jesus is identified as the firstborn from the dead. Well, Paul talks about this hope in 1 Corinthians 15. And Paul is responding to those who do not believe in the resurrection. And beginning in verse 16, here's what Paul says. "For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man." So I want us to consider this hopeless picture that Peter paints for us here. Because I always believe that the good news is always better if we understand how bad things would be without it. For example, we may see people celebrating in the middle of a rainstorm, jumping up and down, and we kind of look at them and say, hey, whoa, just rain. But imagine if it hadn't rained for months. Changes things. Well, it says, if Jesus has not been raised, and our faith is futile. What does that word futile mean? Webster defines it this way, serving no useful purpose, completely ineffective. And then Paul adds, if Jesus has not been raised, then you are still in your sins. What does he mean by that? Jesus did really die on a cross. And what it means is this, if Jesus died and was never raised, then his death did nothing to accomplish justification, which is being declared not guilty. God raising Jesus from the dead showed God's acceptance of Christ's sacrifice on the cross. If God had left Jesus in the grave, then the sacrifice he paid on the cross was not accepted, and no one received cleansing from sin. In Romans 6:23, Paul tells us that the wages of sin is death. If we have not been cleansed for our sin, then we will have to pay the penalty of death with no chance of being resurrected. And further, if Jesus has not been raised, then those who have fallen asleep or died are lost. Lost with no chance of seeing them again. This, my friends, is the bad news without resurrection. And that would be a terrible situation. Just like life without hope is a terrible situation. But then in verse 20, Paul says, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. And then he adds a description of Jesus as the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Same thing we see in Revelation. He's the first, but there'll be others coming. Then Paul says, for since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. Of course, the man that the resurrection comes through here is Jesus. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we know that we also will be one day. Now, obviously, we talked about this last week, right? This is our living hope. But I know that most of us in this room have stood beside the grave of someone that we love. And I do not believe there is any deeper pain or grief than that. But now, think about how much more painful and difficult it would be without the living hope that we have. Paul talks about that in 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13. He says, brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. See, he doesn't want us to be like that without hope. He wants to help us in our grief. Now, for sure, the women at the tomb that first Easter morning, they had only been grieving for 3 days. And while it was an awful 3 days for them, our grief goes on much longer as we await the return of Jesus. But just imagine how incredible your reunion is going to be with your loved one after waiting all this time. Now, go back to our scripture. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. I want to look at this idea of sharing our hope. Again, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. So what do we do with Easter? This is what we do with Easter. We tell people about the hope we have because of Easter, or really what Jesus did on Easter, namely rising from the dead. Now you'll notice, or hopefully you notice, that the title of my message this morning is Easter Survey. Some of you may be thinking that I'm going to ask you to give a review of our Easter service, and know that it's not what I'm talking about. But have you noticed, though, that everyone wants you to give a review of something these days? Almost all the sales slips that you get have an opportunity for you to give a review, either of something you bought or the service you received. And of course, most of these either give you a coupon for a future purpose if you do their review, or you're entered into some drawing for a prize. By the way, have you ever known anyone that won one of these prizes?
No.
I never have. But we also get all kinds of emails asking us to give a review for something we've purchased. Or if we do almost anything or have any interaction with a company, then they want us to give a review of what they did and how helpful they were. Even the post office wants you to give a review of a service you received there. Why do they do this? Well, part of it, I think, is that they really do want to know how they're doing. But I think a big part of it is that they know that one of the biggest keys to advertising is word of mouth. And I think that's especially key for local restaurants and small local businesses. However, I also think that Paul knows how important it is that we share about the hope that we have from God. And this is why he says, always be prepared to give an answer. Now, think about the flip side of this thought for a moment. Let's say someone comes up to you and says, hey, you go to church, right? What do you like about church? Tell me, what does it do for you? What would happen if you responded by saying something like this? Well, I don't know. I figure it's the least I can do. I'll tell you what's going to happen. That person is not going to go rushing to church. But I know that many are scared of this type of thing, right? We say, oh, I don't know what to say. And the problem is, I believe, that we make it too complicated. We don't have to be quoting scriptures left and right. What does Paul say again? Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who gives you or asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. It's just like one of those reviews or those surveys. You're sharing what it means to you. He says to give the reason for the hope that you have. Now again, we've been talking about the hope that Easter gives us. It's a living hope. It gives us hope even in the face of death. Now, as a church, obviously, we've been painfully reminded of this recently. And really, I think it's too fresh to be able to share about that quite yet. But I want to share with you the hope that I have. This May 21st, it will be 5 years since we lost my mom. And I know full well, as many of you do, the pain of losing a loved one. It's real. Does time heal all wounds, as they say? Well, not really. It may not be as acute as it was at first, but you never stop missing the person. You go on with life because you have to, but the pain of the loss doesn't simply go away. Hey, I'll be honest, 5 years later, I still miss my mom terribly. I still wish I could call her and talk about Kristen's wedding, or about Jake's Eagle ceremony or a graduation coming up. I missed her being there at the wedding. I still miss her being with us on Easter. I'm sad that my kids don't have that time with her. My mom loved her family. And I still, in many ways, feel like I did when she first passed. I'm happy for her. She's not in pain anymore. And for the fact that I know in her next waking moment, she'll be with the Lord. But I'm still not really happy for me. I still miss her, wish she was here. But listen, at the end of the day, I know I'll see her again. I know that the day she died was not the last time that I'm going to see her. I know I will see her again because my mom loved Jesus as her Lord and Savior. And because God raised Jesus from the dead, someday he's also going to raise her back to life. This is what my hope in the Lord has given me. An assurance. Did you hear that word? Assurance that I will see my mom again. But you know what? This is only one part of the hope that he gives us. I know that many of you have incredible stories that you could talk about and share what he's done for you. Some of you have gone through some sickness and made it through the other side. Some of you maybe can share about the way he provided for you in a difficult time. Maybe the way he sent someone else to help you through a tough ordeal.
Some maybe have dealt with some kind of addiction to drugs or alcohol. And if that's you, I know that it was God who helped you. And I could go on and on with this list. My friends, listen, these are things that we should not be keeping to ourselves. God helps us through these things because he loves us. But I believe he also helps us so that we can help someone else who's going through the same thing. And as Paul says, he wants us to be able to give an answer for the hope that we have. Which brings me to another thing about all these reviews and surveys that companies ask us to do all the time. Usually at some point, you'll get a question like this. How likely are you to recommend us to your friends and family? And this morning, this is a huge question for us to think about. Because when we're talking about the hope that we have because of our faith in Jesus, this question is much more important than recommending a phone service or a bank or even the best coffee in town. Here's what it comes down to, I believe. And it's kind of a two-part answer. The first part is about what we're sharing. Is it something that we believe is important enough to share? Well, let's think about if we're giving some review again. What would it take for us to tell our friends or family about it? It has to be something that benefits us, right? If we were to go to a restaurant and the service was bad or the food was cold, chances are we're not telling our friends about it, right? Or maybe telling them to avoid it. But the hope that we're talking about is huge. It's something that every single one of us needs. Every single one of us is going to lose loved one at some point or face our own mortality. And there's nothing, listen, there is nothing that can help us in those situations besides our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior. See, reality is that this hope is a life or death situation. Every person you live next to, work with, are related to, see at the store, get cut off in traffic by, sit on the bus next to, are friends with, all of them need this hope, this living hope that we have. And the answer for all of us should be that we're highly likely to recommend Jesus to our friends and family. Paul says we should always be prepared. But then again, the problem becomes we're either nervous to talk about Jesus to others or just don't know what to say. Again, I point you, remember what Paul says. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you, to give the reason for the hope that you have. You see, it's my belief again that we tend to make this harder than it has to be. Listen, you're simply sharing the reason for the hope that you have. See, I don't think we even need to be in the mode of trying to convince anyone. That's the job of the Holy Spirit. Many times it's simply planting a seed that someone else may come along and water before it sprouts. Well, the other part, that two-part answer, is how likely are we to recommend is who we're sharing it with. How important is your family and friends to you? Are they important enough that you would want to give them hope for some of the most difficult times that life can throw at them? Are they important enough for us to help prepare them for facing their own death or the death of their loved ones? Well, listen, if the answer is no, then you don't love your family and friends that much. You see, it's almost like they're drowning. And you're holding a life preserver, but you don't throw it to them. Now, I know that sounds dramatic, but isn't it true, ultimately? Listen, if you truly believe in Jesus Christ and the hope that our faith in him can give us, why aren't you sharing it? Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Now, I know that there are some who have the gift of evangelism. They can talk about their faith to anyone at any time. And thank God for them and that gift. But we all don't have that same gift, do we? But I believe that if we are truly living out our faith, then we will be a light to those around us. I think that's the kind of thing that Peter says at the beginning of verse 15. He says, but in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. If Jesus is the Lord of our life, and we live like that, then we will be a light. And for those living in darkness, which is much of our world, they will see that light. And somewhere down the road, someone is going to ask you about that light, about that hope that you have. And our job, I believe, is to be prepared for those questions. Again, by simply sharing what God has done for you and how he's given you hope. So every time you see one of these sales slips in the days ahead, asking you to give a review, think about giving an answer for the hope that you have in Jesus. Look around in our world. There are people who are literally drowning. Throw them that life preserver that is the hope that we have in Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your word. Lord, we thank you so much for the hope that we have. The living hope that we have, Lord, in you. Lord, I know that so many people in this world today need that hope. God, help us to be able to share that hope. Help us to be able to give an answer for the reason for the hope that we have in you. Thank you, Lord. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, you stand with us. We're going to close by singing Our God Reigns, which is number 268 in the hymnal.
Next, the way the worship team. Next week, the worship team is going to probably be introducing a new song called The Commission. And it really is about our commission, the commission that Christ gave his disciples, but we as disciples, he also gave us. So anybody that wants to become familiar with that song, it's called The Commission. If you have computers, YouTube, you can look it up. And we will be featuring Hannah on that. Thank you.
encourage you before we pray. You know, again, we're looking at the idea of being given the reason for the hope that we have. We can wait, and people may come to us, but if we begin to ask the Lord, Lord, give me an opportunity, I'm going to guess that God is going to answer that request. So our job is to be ready, because we have a wonderful hope to share. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Thank you, God, so much for this time that we could share together. Thank you, Lord, for being here with us and for teaching us and speaking to us, God. And Lord, right now, we just ask that you would put people in our path that may even ask us questions that will give us an opportunity to share the hope that we have that all comes from you. Thank you for coming to this earth, Jesus, dying on the cross for us, and then rising from the dead, defeating death once and for all. And thank you for the hope that gives us today. Thank you, Lord. I pray all these things in that name of Jesus. Amen.